So, hello everybody. I'm very happy to be here with you today, this beautiful foundation for the contemplation of nature, in a very beautiful place in Majhkhali, in the foothills of the Himalayas. And not only the place, but the person animating it, Ajay Rasturi, who has been treating me very, very well for the last 3 weeks. He made a beautiful workshop, first on Tai Chi and Qigong. Could explore, exchange, dialogue. And we went to quite a lot of different spiritual places together. It was also like a very, very nice thing to do. And then I could spend also a little time to, well, actually contemplate nature and contemplate the silence that is here. And so I was thinking tomorrow I have to go back to the plains, to Big Delhi. And so I was thinking it would be a nice thing to somehow conclude, you know, the beautiful stay here. And so one of the things which struck me very much during that stay was, well, the beautiful exchanges, sharing and dialogues we had, which is something which is very important for me also, like to exchange with people and grow by exchanging with people. And on the other hand, this beauty of silence, especially as I had spent like a whole week before in Delhi. So you have a big contrast coming from Delhi, and suddenly you're here. And it does really seem that this kind of environment also helps to quiet down and thus helps to start to listen more. And so actually starts to really dialogue with the others, ourselves, the environment which is there, and beyond. And so that is why I thought it may be a nice thing actually to conclude this little stay here with some thoughts on silence and dialogue. You know, sometimes it may seem a bit funny, you know, like why put both together, because they seem to be the opposite. But many years ago, there's a very, very dear friend of mine, his name is Robert Vachon, and he was the scientific director of the Intercultural Institute of Montreal, so which was devoted to intercultural dialogue. He started this in the 60s and it went on for 50 years. And so many years ago, he went to a conference by Raimon Panikkar, who is a big philosopher, like really devoted his whole life to interreligious and intercultural dialogue. Raimon Panikkar started his conference by saying, "What I'm going to say cannot be said. And it is because it cannot be said that it's worth to try to say it." And so Robert Vachon had written this down. And so one day when I talked with him, he said, so I wrote this down, and I didn't really realize this thing. But then when I went home, I read what I had written. He said, this became the lines for my whole life. So you see, it's this thing, speech can be very silent. In the sense that you try to say those things which are beyond the words and you somehow try to express them. And so when we're doing this, actually, we speak silent words. On the other hand, sometimes we have very, very noisy silences also. And so I found it interesting from that point of view to explore a little. What does this mean, this relationship of silence, dialogue, and maybe something which is also in between, which is listening. And one of the things that we did a lot in our Tai Chi and Qigong workshop, well, is to start to listen. How do we move? How does it feel? As one of my Tai Chi masters likes to say a lot, he says, each movement that you're doing, you should taste like a good cup of tea. And the Chinese, they love tea very much. So every movement that you're doing, you should taste it. So on the one hand, you enjoy it, but you also taste what is there inside. So each time you practice, little by little also your listening gets deeper. You start to hear maybe other things. So that's why I would like to share these things. And so what we'll try to do is first have a little look at what is noise and what is silence. Then have a little idea of what do we mean when we say dialogue. And then I would just like to say a few words on how can we dialogue on the one hand with ourselves, with others, with nature and beyond. And then we'll just have a little discussion on if you have some questions or commentaries or criticisms or whatever, so we can have a little discussion after. So let's start maybe with the noise. Some environments are very noisy, especially if you come from Delhi. Lots of noise. And not only that, you already have lots of noise, but people like to make lots of noise. You wake up in the morning first to put on the radio, maybe there's a television in the background. So just even from the external point of view, there's a lot of noise. But this noise is not only outside. Also inside, we're very, very busy. Many, many thoughts, many, many preoccupations, many, many things are going on all of the time. So it's very difficult actually to just find some stillness, to be here. And sometimes it seems to me that noise, it's also a little like, I don't know if some of you like cars a lot, right? Some of my friends, they really like their cars. And so when they drive their car, you know, they're always here. They're like, oh, there is one little noise, you know, like I should go and see, you know, like if there's something to be oiled or whatever. So what is this kind of noise? It tells us that something is not smooth. There is some friction. There is some not harmonious working. Same thing when we look like at our health. When you start to have pain somewhere, it's like a noise. When you're feeling healthy, you don't feel something very special. You just feel fine. And at the moment, you start, then this kind of noise is coming. So again, it means there's something which is not harmonious in a certain way, something which is out of smoothness, out of harmony. So in the same way, like outside, inside we have noises. But then, for example, you come here, there's also noise. You have the birds, you have the little crickets, you have the leopards. They all make all kinds of noises. But it doesn't seem noisy. It gives a very silent kind of feeling. You're sitting there and there's all these sounds, but at the same time there's a silent feeling about it. So we can see that what makes, at least to my understanding, noises noisy is at the moment when they start to be not in harmony anymore. When there's some friction, when there's no smoothness. And it's noise, it's irritating. People, sometimes when they shout a lot, you know, they speak in a very aggressive way. It's very, that's noise. And then on the other hand, when other people speak or when you listen to the sounds of nature, it's very, very peaceful as such. So the first idea I would like to convey is that like noise is not necessarily because we hear something, it's noisy. But because we have a thought, it's noisy as such. There are certain thoughts, there are certain perceptions which may be actually like very, very peaceful because they come from this like open environment. They're open. So this openness leads us to the silence part. Yeah? For me, openness is very much related to silence. I'll explain why. Again, you can see silence in two ways. You can have a very deadly silence. I'm not talking to you. So what is this kind of silence? It's really like you're closing down. And so it can feel even very, very, very painful. Like somebody, you know, very heavy kind of silence. Don't talk! Everybody quiet! You know? Then maybe outside you don't have any kind of noise, but inside it's very noisy in a certain way because, you know, so you hear the cringing, you say? Like, oh, you try to keep, you know, you would like to say something, but you're not saying, you know. So it's a lot of noise, actually. So that would be like a violent kind of silence, or a closed silence. And then you have another silence, which is quite the opposite. which is actually opening up, completely open up. You let that what is reflect. So we had a little discussion yesterday, I think, about why practices like, for example, fasting or these kind of things can be beneficial, you know, for knowing oneself beyond. And it's a little like if you have a glass of water which is mixed with a lot of dirt, you agitate it, everything is dirty. So if you have a pond which is dirty like this, the moon cannot be reflected in that pond. If you start to settle that water, and the water can just settle down, sink down, you will have like all the earth and mud which will go down, water will come up. Then you will have some clear water, then the moon can be reflected. But at the same time, if you have lots of wind and you have waves, you may have a reflection of the moon, but at the same time, the moon will be reflected in a very distorted way. So again, if you really want to have a very smooth, clear reflection, you need to have a very silent, calm kind of water. But that kind of silence is completely open. Because it's open, it allows everything which is there to be reflected, to come out of it. It's very harmonious. So obviously the kind of silence that we're interested in, like when I talk about silence and dialogue, is this kind of silence. How to open up. How to create a space inside of all these noises. You know, when you have all these noises, your mind is scattered everywhere. How can you open up a space where you're not anymore caught up in all these things, but maybe where you can connect on a deeper level? Like on one hand with yourself, and also then with others, nature, and beauty. Talking with Ajay, he said like they have this practice that they propose in workshops, to do half an hour of contemplating of nature before starting to talk. Because if you immediately start to talk, everybody's coming with their things, and you know, it's, you don't even take the time to acknowledge that we're here together, and okay, now I listen. And I'm not here like to show off. You're not here to show off. Also, I don't have to protect myself, you know, in the sense of, oh, I'm not going to say this because something like this. But we're genuinely here, we open up, and we're here to share. And we're here to give that space to hear things maybe which we don't like. Maybe another person is saying things which we disagree with. But instead of immediately feeling like, you know, that would be like a noisy reaction, you know, immediately, oh, like this, okay, listen to it in a contemplative way. Then you can make your opinion, you can answer to that. You must not agree with it, but you allow for that space of a sharing to emerge. So this little by little brings us to a kind of transition from noise to silence to dialogue. Raimon Panikkar, whom I mentioned before, I think he made a very, very useful distinction, which I used a lot actually with my students when I was teaching them like anthropology of law. He was saying, I'm using his words. It's maybe a little big words, but it's useful to think. He says we should distinguish between two kinds of dialogues. One he called like a dialectical dialogue, and the other one he called like a dialogical dialogue. What does he mean by dialectical dialogue? It means it's a dialogue where basically we function just in terms of reason or intellect. We discuss something, how much is 2 plus 2? 5? No? 4? Okay? So it's just about, more, let's say, checking facts. Having arguments, counter-arguments, and then by these arguments and counter-arguments, little by little, coming closer to truth. In one of his books, I don't remember which one, he said, dialectical dialogue is a little like hunting for truth with the rifle of reason. You think that all of reality can be understood just by the intellect. And so everything that we have to do is to have like the most rational dialogue. In this way we will come to some kind of universal understanding of what the world is about. So he says this is very important. And it's especially important once we have the same premises. For example, I don't know, we work in mathematics or we're doing some project on something very defined. Then inside of that framework, it's very important that we also have that kind of dialogue, because that is what will allow us to, well, check errors, become aware of errors, make improvements, move forward. And at the same time, he said, it may be very, very counterproductive if we use that kind of dialogue when we want to dialogue, for example, with another human being who may not have the same assumptions as we have. Can be like your own family, like your brother, like my brother, some very different points of views than I have, or your parents, or and then maybe sometimes it even becomes bigger between different cultures. You know, like one culture and another culture is a very different underlying assumptions are there. So then he says it's not enough anymore to talk about some objects, you know, as if the world was just an object. We are subjects, we have perceptions. So how to understand or to hear the perception of the other person. Every person, without knowing it, has his own window to look at the world. And the nicer the window is, and the cleaner the window is, the less you see the window. Because, you know, it's so beautiful, and the larger it is, you have the impression you have everything. But then if you meet somebody who looks from another window, if you approach it like from this first kind of dialogue, and you say something else than you're saying, you will feel, oh, you're wrong. Because you're going to have this debate of right, wrong, arguments, counter-arguments, we must see the same thing. But if maybe you understand, oh, maybe he's telling me something else. Maybe it's not about really being right or wrong by looking through the same window, but maybe he's talking about some other window. Then little by little what starts to happen is, that you realize that on the one hand you have a window, you realize that the other person has a window, and you start to realize that the world is much, much more richer than you thought before. So on the one hand it can be very scary, you know, because you thought you had your window and suddenly people tell you there's something else also. But on the other hand it can be very enriching, because like, wow, you know, I already had all these beautiful things and there's so much more beautiful things. And in that kind of perception, it is the unsaid underlying things which inform our way of relating to the world, which become very important. And it's, for example, when for me, I'm giving an example like of anthropology of law, because that's what I was doing. We have our culture like where there is law. Now you go to some different cultures, there was no concept of law as such. So like what? You must have law. Everybody must have law. No, it doesn't exist as such. So either you come to the conclusion that they are primitive and they don't have it and you must now civilize them or this kind of thing, or you try to understand what do you have? What is your underlying world vision? And when you start to do this, you also start to realize that you were not even aware that on a very deep, very unknown part of yourself, you were rooted in something that you didn't know anything about. And that's why again, Robert Vachon, so I'd like to quote him about that. He used to say, the other that we encounter. And for me, the other would not only be another human being. It can be also nature, it can be anything. He says it's not a void to be filled. It's not like you're talking to somebody and she says, oh, we don't have law. And then you're like, oh, you don't have, you know, you're missing this, you're missing that, and so on and so on. So it's not a void to be filled. It's a plenitude to be discovered. You have so many things, you have your whole existence, your whole history, your whole culture. So start to listen to this plenitude. And I have taken that, so it made me think a lot, and it has become a little my motto. I have changed just a little. This brings us back again to this question of life in relationship to silence and noise, and it's more a dialogue approach to life as such. It's to say life is not a void to be filled. It's a plenitude to be discovered. And so much time we fill our lives as if like we were not allowed to be here or something, and so we have to justify, you know, so we have to have a good career and we have to do this and we have to achieve that, and you know, we make ourselves very noisy because we want to fill that life. Instead of saying, oh, give it some space. Let it happen. Maybe you will feel that there is a lot of beauty which is there. Let that space open so that this beauty can actually come out. If you keep yourself busy with plenty of things, when do you ever allow any beauty to unfold? Or beauty which is unfolding, you just look around you, this beautiful environment, you don't see it even. Because as somebody I will not name, when you're on the beautiful pilgrimages or whatever, hello, so can meet, are you coming now, like 3 o'clock, no, okay. Just sometimes you may be in the most beautiful places, but even the beauty which is already there, we don't see. And why? Because we keep ourselves noisy and busy by trying to fill something which means no need to be filled, which rather needs that we listen and let it unfold. And so, talking about this with Robert Vachon, I asked him, I said, like, Robert, what do you think? So, for you, this whole dialogue thing, because his whole life was devoted to dialogue, no? He said, so it's listening. He said, yes. It's listening. But it's not only listening with your ears. It's listening with your heart. And deeper than that, it's listening with your soul. He said that if you want to listen with your soul, first you have to empty yourself. And once you empty yourself, it was very interesting, he said, then things come and talk to you. He didn't just say, like, then human beings come and talk to you. Everything starts to talk to you. And you start to have a dialogue, like with the trees, with the sun, with everything which is there. Suddenly, also things become alive. You know, you start to be in a relationship. It's not anymore just an object. You know the tree? It becomes a subject. It also tells you something. And it's a little like, I like this thing, you know, when you were saying, made an interview with Ajay not very long ago. He said, don't only conserve nature because it's our duty, but because of its beauty. So already when you start to see the beauty, you get in this contemplative kind of relationship, foundation for the contemplation of nature. And at the moment you contemplate actually what is happening, you cannot contemplate just from outside. That's not contemplation, that is just like watching or something like this. Contemplating means that somehow there is a link. You let it enter yourself. So sometimes they say that real knowledge is only possible with love. If you don't love something, you don't let it enter. So it will remain outside. So it's some kind of objective knowledge, but it's not something which you become part of, which you really experience very, very deeply. So, now when we take this idea of dialogue, then for me it took many years, but little by little I became aware that there's maybe really like these four levels which are very much interconnected actually. First one is, do we take time to listen to ourselves? And when I'm saying this now, I'm talking like in 1, 2, 3, 4, but all of these are of course connected. It's just like when you talk, you cannot give everything at once, so you have to split it up. Do we take the time? Again, we keep ourselves so busy that our parents told us maybe that okay, they have been dentists or whatever, just thought of a friend who is. So you also become a dentist, or you also become a lawyer, you also become this or that. And then, you know, you start certain things, but you never took the time to maybe question, or also have the courage sometimes, you know, to question, is that what your inner voice is telling you? Or what is your inner voice telling you? Are you just acting because of some outside circumstances? Or do you give some space at least to listen to what is going on inside? And there again, the very interesting thing is that really your inner voice is very silent. It doesn't make lots of noise. You have lots of other things that want to convince you to do things which are much more noisy. You need to do it, you know, and maybe the more fishy something is, the bigger the noise. You know, you can do it because it will bring you this and that, and actually it's a good investment, you know, and so on and so on. We have all that. And then there will be just a little feeling there. And then the other part gets even noisier. No, but, you know, and so on and so on and so on. So, are we able to listen to this? And are we able, little by little, to discriminate this little noise, little voice, you see, noise voice, which is inside? And for that, again, if you don't calm down, if you don't quiet down, we cannot hear. At the same time, what is very useful is when we have a dialogue with other people. Because we may not be aware of something, but others tell us, oh, Christoph, be careful, like here. So, because it's coming from outside, it's more, you can hear it better. Still, you may not want to hear it. Family, your friends, others tell you something, but you shut off, you don't want to hear it. But if you start to listen to it, again, so we again have to have this like attitude of opening up, then it may point. See, this dialogical dialogue I was telling before, and understanding where the other person is standing. Little by little, you also understand more where you are standing. Talking with friends of mine who are, I don't know, philosophers, or like musicians, or dentists, or lawyers, or shopkeepers, or you find that's not what I am. I like music also, but it's not my vocation, it's not my passion. I like to play a little, but it's not that. But then, through the eyes of the others also, it's like, oh, Christoph, you're good in that, you know, or, and then, so little by little, you also start to understand where are you in relationship to the others. Because you don't exist like this, you know, or alone, like an atom or something. So you're connected to everything. So I like this beautiful Indian idea, dharma, no? You have dharma, and then you have your svadharma. How to find your svadharma? Not in sense of institution, varna, shrama, dharma, you know, just also from outside more. But like, really, what is your inner voice? What is the little instrument that you are playing in this big orchestra, you know, which plays the symphony of life? Are you a flute or a violin, or are you the drums, or what are you? Nobody tells you at the beginning. So, listening to yourself and also exchanging with others who do other things, little by little you can understand better, like, what your specific, maybe, role may be. And this, I think, it's true as much on the level of individuals, also true on the level of cultures. You know, certain cultures have more developed certain aspects, others other aspects. You know, and so, where do we stand, and how can we enrich each other from this? But then the connectedness, like when you start to feel also this human connectedness, little by little also you start to feel much more connected to everything. And just think about it. For any of you to be able to be here, in a certain way you needed a whole universe. You had to have like billions of years of like Big Bang, creation of galaxies, creation of the stars, the sun, all these things had to happen so that you can be here. It's quite amazing when you think about it. Often we take it for granted. You know, this is here, and you know, now I'm here. Okay, you don't see more than that. But at night, you look at the stars, you see all these things, and you're part of all that. And so it's important actually to also listen to these parts of ourselves, not only to save the environment, but we are part of it. We are the environment in a certain way. And in the West, especially in the academic settings, there's very much emphasis on intellect, so it's a mind. And sometimes like the body is a bit looked down, you know, if you're like the sports teacher or something like this, you know, it's like, it's not so good. You know, if you're doing philosophy, then it's the mind. That's what is important. But so that's where the problem starts with the contemplation of nature, you know, like you don't even consider your body as part of nature. And when I say body, we can even talk in the Indian concept of panchakosha, meaning like you have your physical body, but then you have energy body, you have all the different bodies. It's not only like the physical body. But well, this is also part of nature. It's made of pancha mahabhuta, it's made of the five elements. So, I think for many, at least Westerners, like dialogue would probably, especially city people, already start with an openness like to dialogue with and listening to people. But then it's very important, like places like here, that the connectedness goes beyond the pure, like human connectedness, but that we are connected like in this whole big organism which is there. And when I said before, you know, that life is not a void to be filled, it's a plenitude to be discovered. But to say like a human being is not a void to be filled. You will become a doctor and you will get married and you will have children and you will, you know, and fill. But it's a plenitude to be discovered. I don't mean to say a plenitude in the sense I'm so full of myself. No, what is the plenitude? The plenitude is you start to look and you find you're connected to everything. Like I was saying, you really start to look as who am I? And you start to see you're a brother of the stars. You start to look at my name, Christoph. I was very curious about this name. What does it mean exactly? So I'm not going to tell you now the whole story of Christophorus. But it's a saint. In Greek, Christophorus means the one who carries Christ. So actually there's a whole story, and like in the Catholic churches you will see him. He's always carrying the Christ on his shoulder. And Christ, baby Christ, is holding like a little globe. And so he's having this big stick, and he's carrying him across a river. Because actually that's what St. Christoph did, he was carrying people across rivers. And for a very strange reason, I found that in Eastern Europe, sometimes St. Christoph is depicted as a dog-faced saint. We don't have animal-faced saints, you know, like all our saints are human beings. So, where did that come from? You know, I was like, this is very, very, very weird. And so I made some research. And what did I find? I found that in ancient Egypt, there was a god who was called Anubis, was a jackal head god, was also in charge of taking the people who died across to the other world. And then, you know, the Greek and the Egyptians had lots of contacts. And the Greeks had another god, which was called Hermes. And Hermes was this god, you know, like with the little wings on his shoes, and was carrying the messages of the gods. And so at some point there was a new cult which came, which was Hermanubis, where they mixed Hermes and Anubis together. And apparently when the Christian religion took over, Saint Christopher, part of his legend, actually got inspired by this Hermanubis. And that is where this dog face comes from. So why am I telling you this story? It's just to give one kind of example of how you take Christoph, you say, you cannot have a more Christian name. For some people, already Christian, they forgot that it comes from the Middle East. You think it's like a European, Christian, white stuff or something like this. And then you start to look into this a little more, you start to see, oh, okay, there's a Christian thing, but there's Greek things, there's Egyptian things, maybe there's even more than that. And so you start to see that just in this single word, which maybe has seemed very tiny or very like this, there's a whole plenitude of relationships which are there. There's a whole history of exchanges, of cultures, of, you know, all this is there. And so there are so many things when you take the time of a tree. Like a tree is starting to grow. How can the tree grow? Of course you need the seed, but you need the soil, you need the sun, you need the rain, you need so many things that this thing can actually. And where's the water coming from? It's not like the cloud who is waiting there, you know, to just rain from time to time. There's this whole cycle which is going on. So it's this idea that starting to be silent and having like a contemplative approach to things which we may take for granted. Contemplative is also to be able to marvel at things. You know, wow, see it like with the innocent eye again. You're not taking things for granted, it's like this, you know, I've seen it before. I did my Tai Chi already 1,000 times, you know, what's a big effort, you know, just do it like a robot. Then nothing can happen. On the other hand, if each time you're doing something, you experience it like for the first time, you really taste it, then this whole richness is actually coming. And then little by little you also start to discover something else, which is this fourth dimension, which is, although you may discover all these links, although you may discover all these beautiful forms and whatever, it always points somehow beyond. You cannot ever completely say what you want to say. And I love this saying very much, you know, of when they say like the wise man points to the moon and the foolish man looks at the finger. Words point, at least silent words point. You try to point towards something which you cannot express. Most of us, we get caught up in the fingers. My tradition is the best tradition. My guru is the best guru. My professor in our school of philosophy is the best school. And we have to learn by heart, you know, the thing and so on and so on and so on. We have to repeat it, you know, and so on. But do we get the point that these things are just ways to point towards something else? Are we able to not only look at the finger? Oh, look at what it's pointing to. When you read the book, are you able to not only read the words, but like, what was the author trying to convey? What is he talking about? And so you see that there's always this mystery. There's always this open space or this thing which can never be fully expressed. When the Buddha was asked, you know, is there a God or no God? You know, it was one of the questions he never answered in words. But when he was asked that question, he smiled, which is not no answer, it's a silent answer. But certain things you cannot talk about in words. And maybe at the beginning, when we have not started to listen too much, we may not even be aware that this kind of dimension is there. Because we think that everything can be, you know, and maybe we can find this ultimate formula of life. You know, like, I don't know, have you, maybe it's more a Western thing. Has any of you come across this book, like The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Oh, you, yeah. So it's interesting, because they find out after a long time that actually like the whole planet and everything, it's a big computer built by mice, if I remember, to find out what is the meaning of life. And so the computer computes for, I don't know, a million years, a billion years, or something like this, and then everybody gathers, you know, like, so that the computer will finally give its answer. And the computer answers 42. Everybody's like, what kind of answer is that, you know? Meaning of life is 42, you know, what does that mean? And then the computer, like, I don't remember exactly what he says, but then he's like, no, but you have to ask, like, a more meaningful question, you know, because otherwise I cannot come up with something else. But sometimes I have to think about this, like in endeavors, like scientific endeavors. It's a little like we want to find this formula, you know? Life is equal this, you know? And then if we find this, then we're happy, you know? If like we find some Guruji who gives that mantra, you know, which is basically this, you know, then we have it, you know? That's the thing, you know? So what we're doing is we try to limit, again, this thing which is much, 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 much more open. And so it's in the practices that we did, like at the beginning of the the weak, never forget this importance of listening. Because there's no magic in the practices. It's not like, oh, I'm going to do like a certain posture and then suddenly, I don't know, it's like I have inserted a computer chip, you know, will launch some program or something like this. It's not like that. And I've met many people nowadays, you know, yoga is becoming more famous, to say like this, and so yoga therapy is coming more, and with Qigong and all these sites, also like the therapeutical aspects are becoming more and more. And so people start to focus more and more, if I do this, what will it do to me? For which organ is it good? For which, in the Chinese medicine, like energy channel, is it good? But by doing this, you narrow down the practices very much. It may have all these health benefits and so on, but it's a way of enabling you to listen to more and more subtle things. At the beginning, our listening is very gross. Maybe even your body, you're not even aware that you have like a body. And then you start to know that you have a knee because your knee pains. Or you have a back because you have back pain. But before that, you didn't even realize. And then little by little, by listening to what you're doing, oh no, actually I have a body. Oh, actually, and being aware does not mean it must pain so that I can be aware. I can have a positive awareness. It feels good actually to have, you know, like a back. It feels good to have like a legs. It feels good to have arm. And so then little by little, your attention can start to shift. And then it's not only your gross body, then it's like, oh, how is this body feeling? Is it tense? Is it relaxed? Then inside, what is starting to happen? The energy. Maybe you start to feel the energy which is flowing in your body. And maybe little by little, you see that, oh, the energy, but what's the intent? What's the mind which is there? So you start to get aware of these kind of things. And so little by little, by practicing this listening, you can also say in other words, like of being aware. Little by little, what happens is that you start to be aware of more subtle things. And then it's like a river which starts to flow. You know, it's like a source, and whoo, the more you then manage like to work and open up, the more things can start to flow. And you can start to be in a way of living where you let things happen with awareness. It's a little in China, they talk about wu wei, action through non-action. You let things happen through you, and you witness what happens through you, and you enjoy what happens through you. You have this in the idea in India, you know, in karma yoga also. Let the action be done, but you don't cling to the results of the action. That's what needs to be done. Let it be done. Next one. So, to conclude and before opening up like for some more questions, answers. Maybe what I'm trying to say is that, especially in the world which is very busy nowadays, and where we have become champions of over-busying ourselves, it may be worth to take little time. Time is also a space that you create. To open up a little space. To listen for whatever is beautiful for you. If you like painting, painting. If you like to sing, sing. If you like to go and have walks in the beautiful countryside, go for walks. But do it and taste it and enjoy it. And little by little, by giving that kind of thing, when you start to appreciate beauty, because you give the space to appreciate beauty, then little by little you will fall more and more in love actually with beauty. And then you will not want to do unbeautiful things so much, because you're just like, why should I eat this bad food when I can have like this wonderful, we had like a couple of days ago, like in the fire oven, you know, and we opened it, and made the bread ourselves and this thing. You know, once you start like to taste these things, then you're like, wow, it's worth to even take the time to do that instead of getting some chemical whatever food which won't give you this kind of taste and appreciation. So just to say, this dialogue, the idea of like opening up, letting things happen and not be afraid. That is why I'm not only talking about listening but of dialogue. Not being afraid when things also shock you maybe at the beginning. You know, we don't only start to experience things we like. Maybe when we do our Tai Chi at the beginning, like, oh, yo, my back hurts. It means like my back is not very supple yet or something like this. But so we have to establish a relationship with these limitations. It's very important. Not try to break this, but okay, acknowledge it's there. Situations that we don't like or people we disagree with. Also to let that space and to be okay, but instead of immediately have a noisy reaction, where actually we do not learn anything from it, why does it affect me? What can I learn from it? Is there something to take? Is there nothing to take? And at the beginning, you will find that it's very, very scary sometimes. You make, individually it's scary, and then you don't only live alone, but you have like your parents, your family and everybody. Then you say, I'm not going to do like businessman like my parents, and I want to do like an NGO volunteer, you know? And your whole family is like, oh, you know, you cannot do that, you know? And so it takes lots of courage sometimes, you know, to actually like even start to listen, because you don't even want to listen at the beginning. The thought comes, you're like, don't think about this. But as long as you have not done it, at least for the first time, to dare to jump. You know, it's like when you go to the swimming pool, at the beginning you don't dare to jump in, you know? You're standing there. And then at some point you dare to jump. And then it's so much fun, you know, and you want to jump again, 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 and again. With dialogue, it's a little the same thing. It's Robert Vachon, again, I like him very, very much. It's one of my very dear friends. He said he was a Catholic priest also, so like that's why his language is a bit Christian. He says dialogue is crucifying, because you know, when you really have to dialogue, especially like intercultural dialogue, and people come with completely different ideas, and you're completely shaken in everything you thought was sure, and it's not anymore, you know, but liberating. So even though at some moments, listening may not only be harmonious. You may also start to discover many, many not so nice things. Remember the first part of the dialogue with oneself? If you let some space, you know, to let come out everything which is inside. Some of the things we don't want to see so much, you know, because we're rather trying to, you know. But at some point, if you open up, you certainly it's a price to pay, but it's also something you learn in the process. It's, yeah. Have the courage to let those things come up. And if you let, it may be difficult, maybe crucifying, but little by little it will get so much more liberating. Liberating, in other words, it opens you up. And so maybe to really conclude, I would say, you can sum up maybe everything I've been saying in this idea, how do we open up? How do we open up like to ourselves? To others, to all the beautiful environment that we are in, and beyond. Big question. Which again, must not necessarily be a void to be filled. Means you have to give an answer. But the big question mark can also be a plenitude to be discovered. And probably every one of us here, every one of us is a question mark. And our whole life is an exploration of that question mark. You know, and what comes out?
Hmm.
I like the silent effect of the silent conference. So if you have any thoughts you would like to share?
How about expectations? Where do you mean expectations from yourself and others? Is that a noise or is that a voice?
I think there's always a question of degrees. When you start with anything, you first always start with a projection. You see a great karate master, you see a big musician or whatever, you see that you're like, wow, you know, I want to learn that, you know. So you're projecting yourself. And not only it's natural, it's good because it gives you the impulse at the beginning. And I remember, like, I don't really know how to play, but at some point I learned a little to play electric guitar, you know, and you feel like, oh, wow, that's the thing, you know, you want to tell everybody how great electric guitar is, only you're in this passionate phase, you know. We have some people just discover yoga, you know, and they're, oh, everybody should do yoga, you know, like, it's this, like, initial enthusiasm. And which goes with this idea, you have an expectation, you want to become like this master that you have seen, or like this artist that you have seen, you know, it's this inspiration, you know, it's like something which draws you like this. So it's good, but then little by little you also need to learn to let it go. There's a story. It's a student who comes to see a master, let's say a martial arts master. He tells him, "Master, I would like to learn with you. How many years will it take, like, to master your art?" Master says, 10 years? But if I really devote myself to it, like I really will take it very seriously, then how much time will it take? Maybe 5 years, okay, possibly. And he says, okay, but if I will only do this, you know, and I will constantly be working on it, you know, and nothing else, and I will just focus on this and this and this and how long then? The master says, maybe 20 years, but maybe you won't get it. Another saying is, as long as you have one eye on your goal, you only have one eye to be here for your practice. So at some point, forget your expectation. But at the same time, the inspiration that the expectation gives you at the beginning is also important, you know? So it's not that little by little, the more you practice, at least that's my experience, like with the yoga or tai chi or these kind of things, the more you start to practice, the more actually you open up the space of just things to unfold naturally. And you just see that even after, I don't know, 20 years or more of meditating, you still have some days and you just sit there and you don't want to and nothing is happening and, you know, and you're just feeling dull and you just want to get up and, you know, and these things are there. So it's not like, you know, you're starting something and it's going like this. That's again like this other dimension I was talking about of beyond, which is, there is a, like in the Christian tradition, they would talk more about the grace. There's also a grace which is there. You know, things are, it's not like I'm doing, and so because I'm doing, I must have the result. Yeah, you're preparing, you're planting your seed, and you do everything, but then, like weather conditions, all these things, will it give something? Will it not? You may have increased the chances of something to happen. But that it happens is not in your hands. So in a certain way, you start to have also this surrender, which is coming more. You practice, but then you just let the practice unfold. You don't feel so much anymore that we have to achieve this or that level. You just practice and then the levels happen. And then when certain things are happening, then you can just assess where you are on your path. It's like when you're traveling, you know, it's like, oh, that's the tree I've been told about. Oh, now I'm on this mountain peak. But if on the whole journey you're just thinking, I want to be on the mountain peak, and you don't see anything of the environment, then you lose your whole journey. So that's a little like what I would say on this.
Isn't the expectation a milder form of desire, which leads you to either pleasure or disappointment at the end of it? In other words, you are expecting, you are acting for a result. If it happens, you are temporarily happy. If it doesn't happen, you are disappointed. Which is the, should be the other way around. You do it, but you may, it may happen or it may not happen, because everything is entirely not in your own hands. There are many other interactions that are happening which may result into what you think could happen or maybe otherwise. Therefore, having an expectation and sticking to it could lead to disappointments.
Definitely does. Can you just say if you could maybe, because it will come a lot on the... it does. That's why many traditions, but we have to see where people are talking from, say we should cut all the desire part. And it's only if you really completely extinguish, on the one hand, your desire and also your fears, your projections for the future and your memories of the past, that actually you can be free. As long as you're caught up in that game, you're not free, you're bound. That's true. But on a very pragmatic level, how many of us are able to just do this like that? You look at the Western traditions, you look in the Indian tradition, Ishvar Pranidhana. Yeah, surrender to God. Or surrender to the being, or to the Buddha inside, or to Christ inside. Or let your will be done, not mine. You know, in Christian teachings. Yes, if you can do that.
In not having expectation does not mean inaction.
No. Because whenever, see, that's a magnificent thing. The fact of being, I mean, as long as you hear, things happen. And they happen on their own. So you don't need necessarily to, let's put it like this. The problem is that very often we tend to see ourselves as like very, that's me. So if you see that's me, then you feel like if I want to have some kind of action, I have to act. Okay? If you start to have a understanding of yourself, which is not only this, but actually I am, or you are, or we are, the whole situation which is unfolding. Because for you to be there, they had to be your parents. Now, you know, you're connected to all these things. So you're not happening like just like because of you want to do or not to do. You're part of something which is emerging as a whole. And so even if you now don't want, still, in the worst case, if you want, or best case, or whatever, if you really don't do anything anymore, okay, you just still breathe for a certain time, until maybe you die of hunger because you have decided not to eat or something like this, and okay, then it will finish like this. But so the fact that things arise I like the idea, take again this image I gave from the pool and the moon, which is reflected, okay? The more still the pool is, the more perfectly, even the stars can be reflected in that pool at night. So there will be a lot of things which will manifest. We made a very beautiful experiment, like with the Hubble telescope, you know, the astronomical telescope. And a few years ago, they pointed it to one spot in space where there was nothing. I mean, nothing, you know, just complete blackness. And what they did is that they opened the lens, I don't know, for a long time, so I don't know, a day, or I don't remember how much, but like a really, really long time. Just saying, like, let's see, you know, maybe there is something there. And so they kept this open, and they were stunned when they saw the result. There was like, I don't know, hundreds or even thousands of galaxies in that spot where it was just black. Meaning that if you manage to completely, or the more still you become, in a certain way, the more even like things are able to be reflected or manifest to what is here. But what starts to manifest is not so much anymore like my little telescope, you know, or this thing, but what starts to manifest is all this wider thing. So from outside, maybe you will not be able to tell the difference, you know, of this kind of action or the other kind of action. Now, on the desire part, it's again, you know, it's like probably we have to start with desires, because that's where we are. But then what you can do when you start like to listen, for example, is that little by little they become more subtle. And so little by little you may be able actually to, you know, like if you're in a very gross thing at the beginning, you're completely entrapped. Somebody makes you angry, you know, and you beat him. Your anger takes so much control of yourself that there is no space between yourself and the anger. If you quiet down a bit more, I'm angry, put it down. I've created some space, some awareness. You're not imprisoned anymore just in that kind of emotion. And you get to the next step, just the feeling is coming, even your body is not like, oh, I'm starting to be angry. Maybe you start to see what is the energy of the anger which is behind. So what I mean to say is that you start from a very gross thing, or very gross attachments, expectations, desires, which really bind you a lot, you know, where you really, you don't see anything else. You know, you have your troubles, you have your preoccupations, you know, you don't see anything else. And little by little, when you make those more subtle, so you're less imprisoned by the more gross kind of things. You open up a bit more. Your awareness becomes a bit more. In a certain way, you become more free. And then, of course, you open up, you open up, you open up, you open up. Then maybe at the end, you know, there's just a tiny, tiny little ego still, you know, which is there. And, you know, maybe which enjoys so much the state of being so much aware. And they say that sometimes this last little part, which is the most difficult to let go, you know? But so, again, like giving a little like the answer like as I gave to Ajay, from in my sense, it's a bit like a continuum. That if you can do it just like this and you say, woof, okay, my emotions, my feelings, all this, just whatever happens, happen, amazing. But I think for most of us, probably gradually, you know, like refining, and by refining, freeing little by little may also lead you to the point where ultimately you come to what you say, you know, where you abandon all of that game. But at least for me, I'm far away from that.
I did not mean to abandon it. I was trying to explain that the expectations point towards the end product result. Mm. Sometimes the process itself could be very useful and should be the thing that is the end in itself, the process. Mm. It's not necessary that we achieve the end product. So the enjoyment could be in the process itself.
There's a very beautiful story. I don't know if you know that. The whole King Arthur's legend, you know, with the 12 knights of the round table. And maybe this is a very Western approach, because if you look in the Western culture, it's very much there. But it really made me think a lot, and I liked the thing. So at one point, you know, so the kingdom has been pacified, you know, so all these knights don't have anything to do anymore. And so they sit around their round table with King Arthur, and they wonder what to do. And so somebody says, like, okay, before having our dinner, let's wait for some miracle to happen, you know, like, which may give us some indication, you know, of what we should be doing. And so they're all sitting around this round table, and then suddenly you have this holy grail, which appears in the middle of the round table, but it's veiled. And then the vision disappears. So one of the knights proposes, he says, okay, that should be our quest. We should go on the quest to find the holy grail and to see it like face to face, not veiled, you know, but to find it as such. Say, okay. But this quest should be an individual quest. It's not something we can do together. All of us must set out alone. And so there's the forest, you know, like next to the castle. They say the search for everybody should start at the darkest place in the forest. And it should start there where there is no path. Because if there is already a path, it means that somebody has already walked. But you have to go your own path to find that holy grail. So in a certain way, maybe it's very individualistic, you know, like it's very much in the Western point of view. And it's quite a contrast to what I sometimes see like in Indian context, you know, where it's like moksha, samadhi, whatever, which is here. And we have been trying to go there since 5,000 or 10,000 or more years. And so that's the path. And don't stray from the path. Follow the thing, you know. And by following it, you have your highway to reach a destination. And so this other story is, I'm like more, this maybe because I'm European, I don't know. But it reminds me a little of what you're saying, you know. It's not so much only about your final moksha, liberation, kevalya, whatever you want to call it. It's the beauty of the journey.
Yeah, the old poets say that. Mm. Expectation takes you on a journey, but the journey is the reward.
Mm. There's also these beautiful stories, you know, of like people, you know, who have like a dream. I'll tell it in a short way. Has a dream that he will find a treasure by going like in some faraway land or something. So he sets out, you know, and he goes to that faraway land and he looks and looks and doesn't find anything. And at some point he's completely desperate, you know, because he feels like he has really lost his life, you know, spending years of wandering, you know, and he has abandoned, I don't know, he could have got married and he didn't get married and all these things, you know. And so there's a bridge and he wants to drown himself, you know. Before jumping, he meets this other guy, you know, like who's also there. What are you doing here? And don't jump, you know, like this is foolish. Like what brought you, you know, to this despair? And then he tells him, no, I had a dream, you know, telling me that I should go in a faraway country and that I will find like a big treasure there, you know. And I found nothing in my whole life, you know, and so on and so on. Then the other guy tells him, oh, I'm very happy that you told me, you know, because like actually, you know, I also had a dream. And so now you confirm me, you know, that it's not worth to go on that kind of travel because I would have wasted my life. I dreamt that, and he starts to describe a house, you know, and then there's like a chimney, and in the chimney, you know, there's a treasure. And so he's telling this, and the other guy recognizes that's his house. You know, that's actually in his home where the treasure is. So he's like, oh, okay, thank you, I'm going home, I don't want to drown myself anymore. And he just goes home, and indeed the treasure is at home. But then, see, you can say treasure is in yourself, no? But if you want to find the treasure in yourself, you also need to explore all the other things. Because like it's all these other people and experiences which point also at this. And before not experiencing all these things, you cannot appreciate this treasure. And that's why it's my personal feeling why dialogue is so important to me. There's different paths, so I'm not discussing, you know, that term. But I find it beautiful to have like a path of dialogue in the sense that the journey is so beautiful. And then when you also see like all the treasures that the other people are carrying inside of themselves, you know, it's it makes you very happy. Because it's not only about like I'm going to, you know, find something or, you know, it's yeah, as you said it very beautifully, it's like the whole journey, which is a beautiful unfoldment and discovery of the unfoldment of what is going on.
Yeah.
In fact, it reminds me the dialogue and the silence are the two sides of the same coin.
Mm.
If you are not listening silently, I can't be having a dialogue with you.
Mm. Very true.
If nobody is listening, everyone talking, there can't be a dialogue.
See, very often what happens is that also when we're talking about noise, in a certain way, lots of our dialogues are noise. We don't even give the time to dialogue. You need some time to dialogue. But so we're like, okay, I can meet you, maybe, you know, like we can have lunch together or something like this, but then you have to rush for something else. How can you start to even talk? You're going to say, okay, how were you today? Did you see the TV show yesterday? You know, what can you really talk about? So if you want to be able to share a little more like from inside, we need to take the time. It's okay, well, let's sit down. Good cup of tea, which I have not touched yet. We'll take a sip. Spend the night around the cup of tea. Don't need the other things. Then it's a way of having a silence. And then by doing this, maybe the first hour we'll just spend talking about this and this and this. And then little by little, maybe more deeper things we will start to talk about. But in order also to be able to talk about this, we must have the feeling that the person we're talking to is listening. Otherwise, we don't want to talk about like things which are like sacred for ourselves. We want to protect us, we don't want to be hurt. So, listening is also a very, very important part of this art of dialogue. And what I have seen very much also, see even here, like you're listening, you have very contemplative ears or hearts or souls. So because of this, it makes me talk very much. But sometimes, you know, when I give the classes like Tai Chi or something like this, you know, sometimes you don't even know that you know things. And then it's because the people, they know, sometimes they don't even say, but just their presence, it pours out things. You know, again, it's what we were saying before. It's not like I want to say this or that or that or that. It happens.
But last 7 days, you must be having a dialogue with yourself without making a sound.
It's a nice thing to do sometimes. I'm very talkative, you know, so that's why sometimes it's good to keep quiet a bit.
But to further Ajay's question about expectation. Expectation, to my mind, also comes from our different selves and the different selves that make up our composite self are triggered by different forms of our nature, like the nature that is embedded in greed or the nature that is embedded in anger or the nature that is embedded in, let us say, something more elevated. So the expectation, when it comes from which aspect of our different worlds in Buddhism, we carry all these worlds with us. And which world is triggering off which form of expectation? That is where we go a little more deeper and a little more intricate about what kind of expectation. For example, if it's an expectation based on reciprocity of love, or an expectation based on reciprocity of wealth, or based on reciprocity of some other kind of reward. So we have to address each form of expectation in a slightly more different manner, because it can be a father's love for his son. He has an expectation of some return. It's also for an artist or a writer, it's the expectation of the end of a journey, so it is the reward of an artistic product, you know, creativity. So we have very many layers of expectation which are triggered from the different worlds that we carry with us all the time. But when we address our worlds through practices like yours, meditative practices or practices of dialogue or silence, then we generate the baser worlds which are subdued and the higher worlds which come up. And those higher worlds then take us on different journeys of expectation, which can be, as I said, a reward in itself, or if we address our baser worlds because of the kind of activity we do in the day, you know, driving to Gurgaon, then our expectation is to reach quickly because we want to break the traffic rules. Or, you know, it's a different kind. So I think a lot of it lies on our practices, the kind of practices we adopt, spiritual or scientific or intellectual, to create those worlds within us which appeal to a higher nature.
And there I think what is very important is like discrimination.
Yes.
How do you discriminate between, let's say, those things which bind in and imprison you more and more?
Yes.
And those things which open up more
yes.
and more.
Yes.
And so one of the beautiful things, like when you start to listen more, let's say to, you can call it higher or more subtle or more open kind of experiences, is that somehow you start having something to contrast your other experiences to. As long as you imagine you have been born in Delhi somewhere and you have never moved out of Delhi, maybe even like in a slum in Delhi, you have never seen that beautiful landscape. You cannot even imagine what something like this is about. Your whole life has always been like a very hectic life and so on and so on. So you have no reference point, something. I mean, I'm taking that as an example. Of course, you can have your inner life and all these things. And just, you know, it's a... But so at the moment you have this other kind of reference point, you're like, oh, so like there is not only polluted, busy city life. There is also that kind of life. Same thing inside, you know. As long as you have not experienced some more subtle things.
The subtle nature.
Then you don't have a comparison, so it's very difficult to discriminate. So also at the beginning, you know, when you start to taste some of these things, that's why you may get also so very much like enthusiastic, you know, because wow, you know, I never even thought that this kind of thing could exist, you know, and so you're getting very enthusiastic. And so that's why, you know, like, talk about the Buddhist tradition, they say very much like the first thing you have to do, especially if thinking about the Tibetan tradition, starts with the Hinayana path. It's a small vehicle. I cultivate the good deeds and I try to reject the bad deeds. Meaning, basically, like I reject that which will bind me more, which is basically like the bad karma, and I will do that which opens up more, liberates me more, which is like the good karma. So there's even this story of this monk who didn't know how to do it, and then his master told him, just take some stones, you know, and whenever you do something bad, you're aware of it, you put the black stone, and whenever you do something good, you put the white stone. And at the beginning, like this monk, you know, had like this pile of black stones, and there was one white stone, you know. And then little by little, you know, like it started to change. Now at that moment when this starts to happen, like when your way of being becomes more open, less self-centered, because when you become more open also, you know, you start to kind of clean up your own house. So it means that you clean up some of your mess. The more you have cleaned up your own mess, the more you can start to become aware of other people's mess, but also beauty. So, you know, you start to be less self-centered. That's when you enter the Mahayana path, where it's working for everybody, not only like for yourself. And then it's not, for example, Hinayana is very strict, you know, like 5 to 6 meditation, you know, like, because at the beginning you have to be very disciplined, because if you don't, you never meditate, you know, friends come, let's go to the cinema, you know, you never do it. When you start to come to the Mahayana path, where you have your basic foundation, and your friend comes and says, your neighbor knocking on your door at 5:15 because he needs you for something, you say, okay, I'll do that. Because I have to help my neighbor. And so you enlarge the picture. But still Hinayana, Mahayana, you're still in this idea of you want to get enlightenment. So you still try to be like a good person, you know, in order to reach a goal which is beyond. Vajrayana, Tantrayana, they say, if Buddhahood has any meaning, it means it has always been there. It's always there. Actually, you are a Buddha. You don't realize it, but you are. Ramana Maharshi, he was saying this also. He was saying that peace is always present. You only have to get rid of the obstacles which veil it. And the peace is the self, like the higher self. So then in Vajrayana, you say, it's not a question anymore. There is nothing which is good or bad. Everything which is manifest is actually, samsara is nirvana. So then you transcend. It's not even of being good or being bad. Everything which happens is what just happens. Sometimes they also give this difference, not between like karma and dharma. Karma is you're doing. Dharma you don't do anymore. The right thing is done at the right moment for the right persons. For, you know, it's just like the, in the musical orchestra, it's just like the right note which is just happening at the right moment. And so it's completely harmonious. So maybe it's a little, but I think this like what you're pointing to, it's very true. And if you want to simplify, very simplified way, we can say that we have like one maybe lower nature, which is more about like, let's say closing down. You know, like my comfort and this, and like more like this, or my point of view, like this. And then there's this other aspect which is more like opening up. In a certain way, they have to work together. In the fact that you have a physical body, you know, it's like, yeah, I'm clinging to a certain form, you know, otherwise we would not be talking. But to recognize both and then little by little to cultivate these things which open us more is indeed, I think, a very, very important aspect.
Let me give you a living example of expectations. When he called me about this meeting, I was in Hyderabad.
Oh!
I was outside my courtyard and he called. So I'm talking on expectations. The minute he said you are going to having a silence or concluding, he'll say, my expectation was, okay, I'll be learning, it'll be a learning experience for me. That were expectations. But subsequently I thought, it may be a learning, it may not be learning, but the company itself will be enjoyable for me. And the environment I knew around this place will be a good thing to spend the life, few moments of life. So that's, I mean, the minute, you know, our mind is trained in such a way, the minute you say, do something, you do have certain expectations. As long as you don't cling it to the extent to a desire that it is do or die question, kind of a thing, you are okay with it. Okay. Because you do expect something, but also you should say, okay, no, it could be different. It is my thinking, this is the way I am trained, but it could be entirely different experience. As long as you are open to that, then your example of the clean, waveless and clean water, where you can assimilate whatever is being said in its true form, is more meaningful. So it was a good example. The expectations was there, you know. It's very hard to have no expectations.
You see, it makes me think of another thing I've been talking about, thinking about also like during my, I was spending a little time silently. I always feel very uncomfortable.
What were your thoughts?
One of my thoughts was this thought, that whenever I'm in India, like when I was started, I spent quite some time in Pondicherry and, you know, I was teaching karate to some friends and other things to other friends. And, well, that's the Indian thing, so you start to teach people something and then immediately they start to talk, to call you Guruji, Guruji, you know, this kind of thing, and I don't like that. And Guru is a very big word, you know, it's like dispeller of darkness. And so what I witness here in India very much is very much, you know, this like, and it's a beautiful thing also, but like this devotion of a guru, you know, and like who is giving you like the knowledge and all these things. Maybe because I like dialogue so much, for me it's more like guru or like this dispelling of darkness is something that can happen in a situation where people listen and share. We are here, there's, for some reason, this relationship came. We came together. And because we have a certain frame of mind, I'm enlightened by the meeting. I hope you're also somehow enlightened by the meeting. So in a certain way, this kind of guru spirit is kind of manifesting in the sense that it, inspires us, it opens us something. Is it that you are the guru? Guru? I am the guru? You are the guru? No. There's the stories of Musashi, like, who was a swordsman in Japan. And at some point he was supposed to the forest, you know, to train to become a better swordsman. And at some point I think he walks and he hits a stone, you know? And so he gets angry because it hurts very much. And then immediately, oh, you know, thank you, stone, for teaching me like my lack of awareness. So again, you know, how much do you open up? You can open up to a tree, the tree can be your guru. But then, again, like, I wouldn't like to say that it's the tree is the guru. The situation is the guru.
The moment.
The moment where a true sharing, a true mutual listening starts to happen. So then maybe something which vibrates inside of me, you can hear. You know, it's like you play a note, you have two pianos, it will resonate in the other piano. So same thing, like something in me resonates, I put that note, if you listen, maybe it will resonate. Oh, I also have that aspect. And then you tell me something back, oh, it resonates, the path thing, the different natures thing. And it resonates, but at the same time, you put it from a different perspective. So it not only resonates, but it also opens my horizon more. Because I didn't see it exactly in that way. You know, I wouldn't have put it in that way. And, yeah, so that's the kind of thoughts, you know, like, for example, that, and then the other thoughts are just like, why am I still sitting here? What am I doing here? How many days left?
But if you go into silence, you get more time to listen.
Yeah, but then you also get much, much more time to become aware of how busy your mind is.
That's how you start listening to yourself.
Yes.
So they say noise, they can be deafness, and in silence, they can be hearing.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. And see, that's again like different approaches. One approach would be to say, shut out all the noise. You know, like you, by your will, you try to shut things out. Or another kind of approach would be, which I like more, is let that what is be. But by letting it be, you create space. You know, because you and then the thoughts, at some point, you know, it becomes like, yeah, it's like clouds. You watch them and you know, but they're also empty, basically. So then things naturally kind of open up. And even if the thoughts come, they're open thoughts. It's as you were saying with the expectations, you know, but you're not imprisoned by them. Let them happen, why not? But when it starts happening, don't immediately cling to it and think it through, you know, and this kind of thing. So...
You're saying about the external noise. I've seen some students, they concentrate more in their studies when the TV is at the full volume. Because all the external noises are shut off by the thing that they are not paying any attention to. So...
That
there are many ways to shut the noise off, internal as well as external.
You see, for me it was a very interesting experience first, like if you enter a Catholic church, especially like our old cathedrals, you know, like 500 years ago, 600 years ago, it's silent. You know, you open, I mean, the whole atmosphere, there is an atmosphere of silence. Then you have these beautiful painted windows, you know, so it's a very silent experience, silent and peaceful. So the first times I came to some Hindu temples, you know, it was like, I was like, what? This is a temple? You know, like, you have so much, like, going on. And so, yes, you can actually, you can find the stillness, like, in stillness, but you can also find stillness in, when there's so much noise, that there's an overload, actually, you know, of noise, that actually you have to, automatically, you kind of center. Because it's just, like, so much overload, you know, that it's, and becomes silent again. So that's the interesting thing also, you know, like how sometimes very opposite paths, you know, like may actually lead to very similar experiences. But I would suggest maybe, because we talked about theory and practice, you know, and like time is also moving on. So maybe if we can continue then on also chatting a bit, maybe around a cup of tea, you know, like because to the little they're getting cold. But so maybe... close this discussion and then maybe do a little of these practices, watch the practices if you're interested, and maybe this will even give you some other like inspirations or something. Maybe just before stopping, if you take maybe like 1 minute of silence, to sit together silently, so to share a little, not only like with the words, but just to sit a little. Thank you for the beautiful company.
Thank you.
There's something hot and sweet we should eat before we eat.
Can I? This is the toilet. Can I use it?
Please, it's a
pandemic. Now comes delivery time.
All right.